Dr. Indumati Nambi to come and deliver what IIT Madras is doing with water management. Dr. Indumati was an Anna University graduate, and she did dual doctorates from Clarkson University in US. It's in upstate New York. She did both civil engineering as well as environmental engineering. IIT Madras is already doing much work on water management in nearby ponds and lakes in Chennai. So I would like to have Dr. Indumati on board. Ma'am, it's all yours, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Bhaskar, Shiv Kumar, and Dr. SKS for organizing this. So it all happened when I met Dr. SKS in Delhi a few months ago. I got to know about the wonderful work they are doing, and we are planning to partner also. So this is an opportunity to tell what IIT has been doing. We have been involved in lake restoration for the last 3 to 4 years. Some of our projects are ongoing. When we entered this, we found that many of the lake restoration works are done in isolation, are planned in isolation. So particularly, not only the lakes are connected, but also the lake and groundwater is connected. So, and we have to look at the history and the future. So those are all the gaps we thought we will address when we take up lake restoration projects. So I'll quickly go through two of the projects which I've been involved in recent times. I'm going to share my screen.
Yes, madam. Can
you please enable screen sharing?
One second.
So in Chennai, we have been working mostly in urban areas now, mostly peri-urban areas. So Chennai, as you know, is expanding, and it has gone into the rural areas now. So some of these lakes, which were originally irrigation tanks, are now completely, they have lost their functionality as an irrigation tank. And completely urbanized scenarios, what you see, which has led to a lot of consequences. So I will walk you through a couple of the projects. Go to the slideshow mode. Can you see the slides?
Yes, madam.
Okay. So we can extend the same principles to any rural lakes also, which will be much easier, I would say, in comparison to what we see in the urban systems. Many of us are living in the cities, and we know what is the plight of the lakes. Okay, and very recently, it was a wake-up call for Chennai, followed by Kerala the next year. Floods. We have never been devastated by floods. A slight increase in rainfall, intensity of the rainfall. It was not a lot of water, but we were not able to handle it. So it was a wake-up call, and that's when people started looking at lake restoration as a way to deal with this flooding problem. Already Chennai has been facing drought problem. We never thought of the lakes when we had the drought. We went to the sea and we started putting up desalination plants, but the floods brought the attention to the lakes, which I'm very happy about. Always I think these disasters are blessing in disguise. So at least then a lot of attention has been paid on lake restoration in Chennai. So one of such lakes are in the south of Chennai, a little extreme south in Sirisseri, where TCS has this huge office with 25,000 employees. So TCS wanted to handle the lake, the flood issues by managing the lakes around it, and particularly the two lakes here, Periyeri and Chitteri, is what they wanted to restore. And when they came to us, we started looking at what is the history. That's what we do with all our projects. So the history, when you go back even as early as 2000, not very long ago, the area was like this. So entirely it was irrigated and partly there was cultivation and partly open land. Water was coming back from Buckingham Canal with all these drainage patterns. But soon development started, like all along OMR we are seeing. So these drainage channels got chopped off, as you see here visually. Now, and very, very soon, it was all completely gone, with only a small drain trickling into that area, which only has water when it rains. And so the entire area gets flooded from the lakes, which are present on the western side of the region. Okay. So that is one lake where flooding was an issue because of the loss of the connectivity of the water bodies. The other lake is an extremely more complicated, I would say, is the Sembakkam Lake and associated lakes which drain into the Palikaranai marshland. If some of you know about Chennai, we have a huge marshland. And at least 30-40 lakes are connected to this marshland. Now, with this urbanization, what you see here, completely surrounding the lake, there is a lot of issue, like not only cutting off of the channels like what we saw in Siriseri, but also a lot of dumping of wastewater and waste. Okay, so this is a very complex, there is a slum which has encroached and eaten away the lake. There is 22 inlets draining wastewater into the lake. There is a dump site which has been dumping and all kinds of things into the lake. So it's quite complex. Not only that, this lake is also used as water supply, unfortunately. Tankers come and take water from here. Fishing happens, fishing thrives, there's a lot of fish. So this contamination is moving out of the lake also through these. Here, the Nature Conservancy, an NGO from US, they took up this lake for restoration and they came to us for working out a methodology. The approach what IIT does is look at the watershed. Like all water engineers and hydrologists would agree, it's not just a lake in isolation, it is the entire watershed we need to look at. So this is a Palikaranai marshland, what I was talking about. And there's one tributary which is going into the marshland, which has about 8 lakes. There are multiple tributaries like that, which drains into the marshland. So Sembakkam Lake is right here. And we started looking at what comes into the lake and where the outfall goes. So a series of studies have to be done before we even jump into restoration. That's a mistake which many restoration projects do. They just jump into and start dredging the lake and beautifying the lake. The dredged soil is used to create walkways and all that. And people really don't look at what is the basis for dredging. How much should we dredge? Sometimes it is over dredged, sometimes it is under dredged, and then you don't. And every year, the inflows are bringing more and more silt. So it's a perpetual problem and it's a perpetual money-making project. I would put it that way. So can we look at stopping the sediment inflow even before we start dredging? And how much to dredge? Those are the questions we need to answer. A good assessment will tell us all that. And we did bathymetry to map the sediment deposits at the different zones of the lake. I can see the contours here. So this gives us a plan for dredging. How much to dredge and where to dredge. We have gone from slideshow mode, sorry. And then we did a complete assessment of the geology. Geology below the lake, by dredging inside the lake, and we also understood the geology in the periphery of the lake, in the residential areas around the lake. We drilled to take soil samples and assess the different layers of the soil, and we also installed monitoring wells so that we know pre and post scenarios of the quality of water, not only the groundwater level, but also the quality of the water. Is it improving because the lake water quality has improved? So a detailed geological assessment, and then environmental engineering comes in where we look at quality aspects, particularly in urban lakes with wastewater inflow, there is a lot of contamination. and more so in rural areas also, when there is pesticide and fertilizer usage, the lakes get contaminated. So quality is very important, and we map the different parameters to permissible level. So as you see here, all these parameters, TDS is close to permissible levels, but all the other parameters are of these are the range of concentrations we measured, and they are very much higher compared to what is permissible. Ammoniacal nitrogen and phosphates, which cause eutrophication, iron, alkalinity, BOD, COD, which are the sewage related parameters. So the detailed assessment of geology helped us map the terrain below the water. So this is the lake, and then what is the geology like below the lake? Within the lake, this is what you see. This is the silted area. So you know how much to dredge, and compared to what is outside the lake. So we mapped and understood lengthwise, north, south, east, west transect of the lake. There was a lot, since it is a developed area, there was also a lot of building materials which were dumped. So we were able to identify where what material is present, and we could assess, dredging plan. Okay, so then comes the inlets. What are the, it's not just the lake, the 22 inlets around the lake were mapped, and we understood what is the flow it carries, what is the wastewater load it carries. And so we need to develop a protocol for treating the water. So we developed a plan for treating the water at some locations, strategic locations, where collectively multiple inlets will be taken there, treated, and then the water will be let into the lake. So this is the water quality assessment data. So the reds indicate the hotspots. They are very much above the permissible discharge standards. And so these hotspots have to be taken care of in the treatment methods. What, how to treat it and all that comes from the environmental engineering expertise. We also did a scenario analysis. So there can be multiple ways in which we can deal with the problem. So we did multiple scenario analysis based on rough calculations of the loads coming in. Also the governance aspects. This lake is surrounded by three municipalities. Which of the municipalities is easy to work with? That was also taken into consideration when we developed. How realistic is our scenario? We can develop a plan, but we cannot implement it on ground because of certain practical reasons. So we looked at different aspects of governance issues around the lake, and also a residential association. Sometimes they can get very complex. They may or may not be contributing positively to the restoration activities. So based on all that, we developed a scenario which is workable. And so this is what is currently happening. One base, we have planned a treatment strategy, a dredging strategy, and there are partners who are taking up these works, dredging and then the treatment. And then there is an architect firm who's going to work finally after all the core work is done. They'll be looking at using the dredge material to create natural walkways, no paved walkways, nature's, you know, all the walkways in a natural setting. And so the lake can be used by the people who are living there without impacting it in the negative way. So some of the activities which we have already done. A Siriseri project has moved forward. So these are the images of the Siriseri project where I talked about the TCS and the surrounding lakes. So the canals were dredged and deepened. And we actually used my colleague Balaji's expertise in hydrology to understand how much, what kind of, is it a 50-year rainfall? Can we design for a 100-year rainfall or a 50-year rainfall? We decided to design the canals for a 50-year rainfall event. And so these are the images before and after. So in Chennai, there is a rule that the dredge material cannot be taken anywhere. They have to create, it's a huge lake with a lot of dredge material. Hillocks were created. Our partners here are TFC from Aroville. They have been doing a lot of work in Adyar Pooga in Chennai. So they have implemented this project. These hillocks are now getting greener. This is 6 months back, this image was taken. Now they will all become green. So you'll be seeing green islands in the middle of the lake, which will be a habitat for birds and other species. And soon we are waiting for the July rains to see what how the plantations, a lot of plants and trees have been planted based on the indigenous population of flora. And we are waiting to see the greenery pick up on their own. Now that summer is coming, we need to water it also from the water which is left in the lake. But in 6 months' time, I think this place will be transformed into a beautiful oasis. So I would like to invite you all to come and see the projects. In 6 months' time, I think both the projects would have reached completion. So this is my contact details, and thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Chintamani ma'am. You touched on many topics: water quality, subsurface, soil profile, governing bodies are also in the execution phase. You do develop some frictions with them, so their support is also, it's a good way you guys get along with everyone on board to make this. Tamil Nadu is blessed with so many water bodies like this, but we would love to see them all flourish like what you did. So we would be getting along with you on the future to get these things on board at the, you know, we want to see all the water bodies, mostly in the metros, at least we have to flourish them at the earliest down the road. Thank you again, ma'am. We do have one question at this point, but
yes,
just only one question. I'll just want to toss it to you now. Dr. Shankar, he was asking, on the Rani Pet chrome contamination site, why the site is still ideal for so long years without any improvement? Do you have any light on this?
Yeah, I have been involved part of the CPCB committee to evaluate this. Site assessment was done by a consultant. We had evaluated their report and we gave some critical comments. The project is taken up seriously by the governments. But right now the plan is ready, the remediation plan. The implementation is going to be done by the State Pollution Control Board.